Saya. Hola, amigo. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Okay, I've talked now. Now, I just wanted to talk to you about this whole concept of narratives, how these narratives are kind of ensemble, which is what we've got here today came about. We're in our third year of Narratives Hope, and it's a community engagement activity that the Australian Catholic University has embraced. And it's the idea behind it is to give people who often don't have a voice in society the opportunity to put their stories out. Because one would have to, you have to acknowledge that there's a lot of stories out there, a lot of narratives out there that are not necessarily true. So we wanted to get people out there who have the real lived experience, and I have to say, personally, I've been very inspired by these stories and very humbled by the stories. And this enterprise today won't be the last that we could actually take the stories out to a broader audience. Now, what we do have today is, because the story that we presented today was not a single story, it was a conglomerate of many stories. And a few of the people who those stories were based on are here today, and you'll get the opportunity to talk to them and ask them questions. Those walls we kicked into the audience actually have some comments on them. So,
the quarter ball.
If you could read out what's on the ball, if that's right. Yeah, got your glasses. There we go. Yeah, you can read that. Read now. That's an important thing because if you read the papers, you would think it was 99%. Mm-hmm. Okay.
In the melting pot that is Australia, there are 100 religions and 300 different ethnic groups.
Yes.
We are all brothers and sisters in humanity.
Yeah.
It is not illegal to seek refuge in threats to life and in freedoms.
Yes. If there's any others there?
Hope is essential for survival.
Yes, yes. And that's probably a good one to finish, because if you looked at the way the play was sequenced, it was about the journey, which was very treacherous and dangerous, and we wanted to end up in hope, because that's what we all want. All everybody needs in life is hope, and that was to hope for a better future. So I'll hand over to Janine now, and she'll take over the MC duties.
Hi, I just also like to comment that this is in its third year now, and Sharon, we're still have Narratives of Hope being done up at the university. There's some flyers up at the back if you'd like to come and see the stories of the new batch of youth that are coming through. And for this year, we also teamed up with the Lyceum Theatre and Sharon Henry. So we'd really like to thank her for putting up with us, and she really did an amazing job. Quite a number of us would not have ever got up on stage without Sharon making us do it. Another important aspect too of Narratives of Hope too is the acknowledgement that this is Indigenous, Aboriginal land that we're standing on. And we wanted to make sure that that theme kept coming through, that, you know, this land is and always has been Aboriginal land, and new stories are sort of being added to those stories that are there. Now, getting on to the participants, a lot of the story was drawn from Imtiaz's story, which most of us knew. Now, there's a few people down here, Rosalba, Noor, and Muhammad, who were participants. They told their stories 3 years ago. And then we have Elise and Imogen, who who were also mentors. There's a couple of other mentors here. Sue Gledhill over here from ACU mentored Husna up here from Afghanistan. We have Dan from the ACU Library, who's been with us from the start, and which none of this would have happened without them. Then we have Krishna and we have Jack, who part of their community engagement hours that they have to do at ACU is working in a particular program or an organisation supporting people. And so they decided they would do this. And Jack and Krishna never thought they would be up here on stage. So please, later on, if you have any questions to ask them about the process, please do. Now, over here, the Samson, MTS and Husna have been really critical to how successful narratives of hope have been. MTS, as I said, if you go onto our website, you will see the story and also hear Husna talking about what it is to be a young refugee woman living in Australia. So just giving you a little bit of an idea about that, what I would like to do is leave it open now for you to ask any questions, whether you would like to ask Imtiaz about his story, his journey from Pakistan. Imtiaz came out by boat, Samsul, and these are his two brothers here. They came out on humanitarian visas, as did Husna, so they're very open to any questions, as are all of them.
We came a plane.
And how was the situation out there? How did I get you to make it in my
world? Sorry. My parents fled home, Burma, early in the 90s because of violence and discrimination they faced from other ethnic group in Burma. I was very young, but they were born this way, born in Bangladesh in a refugee camp, and I have grown up in a refugee camp as well. My parents were in a refugee camp for 23 years, and then we had a house in a refugee camp where Noor and Mohammed grew up. It was about like 4 square meters, 6 of us sleeping in that house for all my life. They wouldn't have much ideas about the life in refugee camp because Mohammed was grown up here. Yeah. So it was me and my parents who faced the most violence. Mohammed and Noor, they still have some memories of the camp.
Going on, so I just went and did it, and it is out of my comfort zone, but you know, it's been lots of fun and I met new people all the way, so I'm like, heck, I'll do it.
So for me, it was more about gaining respect for the cultural aspect of puppeteering. Before this, I didn't consider myself a very creative person, someone that would do this, but I have found a deep respect for it and for the people who take part in the arts. I've also been deeply inspired, and I just have so much compassion for these people. We've become like a little family. And it's really interesting just to see how we started off. I was very shy, a lot of us were very shy, and like we overthought everything we did, but now we're just so comfortable around each other, and that's because we shared this experience in our stories, and we've inspired each other, and that's it.
So I was really shy in the beginning when we started the puppetry, but when we were getting closer to the performance, I wasn't getting any like really shy. But today I'm not that shy.
I heard of the puppetry. Jenny told me about it, and I was interested, so I joined. At the beginning, I didn't really know what we were doing. And then I reckon the credit goes to Shara because she got us up to this point. Yeah.
I think it was pretty daunting learning a new skill with the puppeteering, but then also I think because we are an ensemble, learning to trust each other. We were practicing in threes with the puppets, so learning to trust the other was a challenge as well. But yeah, incredibly eye-opening, and just really, yeah, really beautiful and really satisfying.
Yeah, like Jimmy was saying, Jack and I got roped into this. We thought we would be doing stuff backstage within engagement hours. But it's been a really good experience, and like some of the others have said, I'm a very shy, socially awkward person. So this has been a really good experience. I recommend it for anyone that's shy to get in and try performance. And yeah, it's just been a really lovely process and very organic, and whatever ideas people come up with, the whole group kind of embraces it and goes with it. So yeah, it's just been a lovely process, and I've met all these amazing people, so it's been very good.
Sharon put up, and I thought, my goodness, these puppets look alive.
like a sea of ocean coming through, and I didn't think that was ever possible. So then I started to believe in the project, and of course it had another ulterior motive, was that it was the opportunity to get stories out, and in a really, I suppose, a unique way for me particularly. And I think I felt that was, I say all credit to Sharon. She gave us the belief that we could do this, and I think we actually pulled it off. But I say this, my story is only a small part, really. I think the real story is these people next to me up here, so I'll hand over to them.
Now, there is one question I'd like to ask, because Imtiaz came, he was going to be in the puppet show, but had, you know, work took over and study for him. So it would be good to hear for Imtiaz what his thoughts were about the representation, and also Husna, who felt quite emotional about it, because, you know, her friends probably have gone through this as well.
Thank you so much, Jimmy. Can I take this opportunity and thank Jimmy and Sharon and the performance and also the audience. Thank you so much for coming and putting this amazing show. That was my story, but when I saw it, my eyes were in tears. And the words that I still remember, and I was sitting behind it, I was back in time in 2015, June, when our overloaded boat, more than 250 people, 200 plus people, we started our journey from Indonesia, and I was only 15 years old at that time. After 3 days, when the boat capsized and we were just holding on to the hull of the boat, there was dead bodies floating beside us, and I wasn't scared of death or drowning anymore. All I wanted is to see my parents, talk with my mom, with my brother and loved ones. And taking all those experience, and I have sort of turned it into a positivity to take the message out to the broader community. And my aim is to create that sort of sense of normalization, as Sharon said that before in a meeting as well, and give that message of hope and peace, because hope, that's something that I've lived with from the boat day till now, transitioning into a new life here in a new country, learning a new language, and being away from my family for 5 years is something that really motivates me to speak for my community and asylum seeker who are still seeking asylum, and people trapped in Nauru and PNG. And there's some pregnant women and sick people who is not allowed to come to Australia and get a first aid medical treatment. There's a lot of challenges and difficulties that we are facing, and I would request and motivate everyone to take the word out to the family, friends and communities, and let them know what's happening in the world and what's happening to other human beings. I always thought that if I practice religion properly, if when I die I would go to heaven, but I don't believe in that. If you practice humanity, you're a living angel on this earth. And no matter what religion, what ethnic background you are from, if you practice humanity, peace, compassion towards others, you're an angel, you're amazing, you're beautiful. And I just want to say thanks to everyone. Thank you.
Absolutely beautiful. The story was beautifully presented. like it was like this story I've like watched it like that verbally in PowerPoints. Now this was so different and emotional as well. As I know Imtiaz for like a long time now, he's a good friend of mine. But this, like, I've watched it so many times, like in PowerPoint or picture or verbally from him. But it's getting like I get more curious about it. Like it's not that I get bored of it or something. It's so like naturally like I have more questions about it. How did you feel? Like he told me like this story like the third time I was like, oh, I didn't know this, and then he said the word impossible in his story was wonderfully presented at SU, and then I was so inspired. I'm still inspired. And last year I was a mentee at Narrative Circle, but this year I am a mentor of Noah, which is good. Yeah, I'm working towards his talk, which is wonderful. And yeah, this experience with Narrative Circle brought me so many things in my life, which is good. And we are step forward to change the world just for a little bit, but we are trying to. And thank you so much, Jenny. Thank you, everyone. Are there any other questions?
I seek help all the time.
So if I don't understand, I just don't sit and say, or come to it. I ask, gladly there was people surrounding me. I got lots of support from my school, like in the school, English, ESL, teachers, extra teachers were there. And then I got good connections, like Jean, and then at school, like from MTA, I got good connections. Like I went all the homework clubs, like all around. Like there was so many homework clubs near my house, so I went everywhere to do my assignment. And then, so I did it. I tried hard to do it now. This year, I didn't know I would go to uni, like literally I didn't know. But then there was other people who said, no, you can, just, you know, try your best, do your QTAP application, you will get into uni. I was like, I'll do a diploma because I was 100% sure that I'm not going to go to uni because I wasn't doing OP because it was too hard for me. So I did 3 OP subjects and then 2 med subjects and then 2 certificates like outside of school tech. The challenges were hard, but my strengths were like my family was always supportive. Like other than that, like the community, like everybody was so supportive to me and wanted me to achieve. That was the big thing. I was not trusting myself, but others was. Other were like, you know, motivated me and he said, you can do it, just try your hard, try your best. And I did. And I proved a lot. The thing is, I never gave up. I was like, no, I will do it. And then I keep continuing doing it. And now I love education. I used to love education still, but I want to do more and more now in my life. So, yeah.
Lovely things about having Pusna at the Australian Catholic Uni is that she's providing a bridge for a lot of people who don't understand about Islam and being a woman and being Muslim. And I remember her saying one of the things that made a difference was that I kept asking her questions all the time because she was very open to answering the questions. And she said when I did that, she realised that it was all right to ask other people, you know, to keep inquiring. And so that's made a big difference in all our lives because sometimes we're a bit scared to ask the people, you know, we're scared we might offend them or something, but a lot of people are open to it. Sansa, can I just ask you, what was it that helped your family be able to come to Australia? If you remember, Muhammad talked about what is this hamburger? He'd never seen a hamburger when he had his first plane flight over here. And I think he picked everything, Dave, just about everything except the tomato. Did you? You ate the tomato. There was something. He ate a little bit and everybody else got the rest.
Hello again. I just wanted to say, firstly, to Imtiaz, I heard his history today and I think he had such a difficult and such a dangerous journey all the way from home. Nobody wants to leave home and your country. Everybody loves their country, like my father did. My father was in a refugee camp for such over 20 years. And when the first opportunity came to us to go to the United States to resettle there, he said no, because he still was hoping that he could one day return to his country and live there. He has his parents passed away in front of him, not actually passed away, killed in front of him. He still wanted to go back, he was hoping that he would be safe. So, yeah, so what's the question, sorry? I think firstly the people, when we first arrived in Brisbane, we were the first group of Rohingya people to arrive in Australia, like as in UN Convention. There were a lot of people even at the airport, they wanted to see us because not many people knew about our group, our ethnicity, like we at our authority, United Nations, we were the most forgotten people on the planet. nobody talk about Taos. I think many of you sitting here right now, you don't even know, you have no idea who Arno Higgins. So we are one of the a small group in Burma, small Muslim Latinx city group in Burma, the most persecuted people on planet. My parents, my grandparents, they were all born there and they are denied their citizenship. So I would say the people around us when we got here, like Janine, since I knew her, she became a big part, she's helping a lot to my family. For example, she's helping Noor, Mohammed and my other brothers with homework. We are really happy the way Australian, the way people treated us, when the way people welcomed us when we got here. There were a lot of people, they were very happy to see us. And they welcomed us. We had a lot of expectation and they really matched. They were more than matching about coming to Australia. We heard many things about Australia. We heard bad things, like people were saying, don't go to Australia, it's a Christian country. They will ask you to change your religion and your culture. No, it's not true. My mom was scared, and when she got here, the first person she saw at the airport was Job, and she was like, there's Muslim. She was our caseworker, and she looked after us for 1 year. So, we say we are really happy to come here, and I feel like home. For 18 years of my life, I felt I had no home, but now I have a home. I have a country, and thank you, Australia.
Yeah, on that note, we might wind it up. But before we do that, Keith. Now, I know this is supposed to happen in the theatre, but we weren't sure when we did it. We had to ask the police. And we're not sure what we're supposed to say, so I'm going to give it to Keith.
Just for being a fantastic director and producer, co-writer, and we're about to go off Broadway with the whole show. Yeah.